Little things, they pay attention to how to position themselves, you know what, in a race so that they can maximize it. Even though he was third or fourth, he wasn't like, sian, lose really, that's it. You know, he was like, hey, I'm gonna do whatever I can, right, to make sure that I'm positioned in the best place to fight for the championship, to fight for the win in the race. You know, and I think in our lives it should be the same as well. Right? Sometimes you might be beaten down, you know, we might be a little bit discouraged by things that are happening around us. But I think we need to learn how to position ourselves and choose to position ourselves in a way to receive breakthrough in our lives. Amen? Alright, so let's turn to 1 Kings chapter 18. Right? We're going to look at this guy called the prophet Elijah. Right? 1 Kings chapter 18. This is basically... There was a famine and a drought for a really long time, 3.5 years in the land, and Elijah was being hunted by this guy called Ahab, right, the prophet Elijah, and one day God said to him, like, hey Elijah, I want you to go and find this guy, go present yourself to Ahab. God was basically telling him, like, hey, go and look for it. Go, not just go and look, but go and present yourself to the guy who's trying to hunt you down and kill you, right? And the Bible didn't record anything about Elijah's response, it just said, so Elijah went to present himself to Ahab. And basically, Ahab's killing all these prophets, he's killing all the Christians and all these things. And Elijah goes and approach him, and he tells the people that the people of God were at a time worshiping the idol Baal, right? And Elijah was telling them, hey, what's up with you guys? You know, like, make up your mind, if the Lord is God, then worship Him, right? And so Elijah went up to Ahab and the prophets of Baal and challenged them, right? Let's challenge, right? We'll have two altars, right? And the God that brings down fire to light up the altar is God, right? He's the most powerful, and everybody agreed. And so the prophets of Baal went first and they chanted all day and did all sorts of things. They even cut themselves, slashed themselves all day, and nothing happened. And then in verse 30, it says this. Then Elijah said to all the people, come here to me. They came to him, and he prepared the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each one of the tribes descended from Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, your name shall be Israel. With the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he dug a trench around it large enough to hold 2 seers of seed. He arranged the wood, cut the wood into pieces, and laid it on the wood. Then he said to them, fill 4 large jars with water and pour it on the offering and on the wood, which was about to be lit on fire. Do it again, he said. They did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered. And they did it the third time. The water ran down around the altar and even filled the trench. At the time of the sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. Let's pray. Lord, today we just want to thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you can do for us, what you have done for us, and what you are going to do for us, God. Lord, today we ask that even as we learn more about your word, even as we learn more about how to position ourselves for the miraculous, for a breakthrough in our lives, God, we invite your Holy Spirit to fill us. We invite your Holy Spirit to come and fill our hearts today. Speak to us, Lord. Open our hearts, open our ears to know what you are saying to us, God. Lord, today we just want to thank you. In the name of Jesus, we all pray. Amen. Right? So, God wants to bring us to a place where, you know, I believe this morning, God wants to bring us to a place where we can lean on Him to receive a breakthrough in our lives. Right? And we need to And in order to do that, we need to position ourselves in a way to tap on God's power. Right? So the first thing we need to do is to position our hearts and attitudes to align with God. Right? To align our hearts and our attitudes to God, to who God is, what He says. Right? Because a heart that is set apart for God is the beginning of breakthrough. Right? A heart that is set apart for God is the beginning of breakthrough. The prophet Elijah, he was someone who is set apart for God. His whole life was living for God. And one of the things when he came up to the people of Israel was he addressed the wavering hearts of the Israelites, right? He says in verse 21, Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow Him. But if Baal is God, follow him." Right? So Elijah, that was one of the things that he addressed first. Right? To be set apart means to surrender control of our lives. Right? Surrender control of every part of our hearts to God. Right? Maybe you're here this morning and you say, and you say, like, "Hey, I need a breakthrough." You know, or maybe today you're here and you're not a Christian, or you don't know, you've never received God in your life. Right? Can I challenge you this morning that if you need a breakthrough in your life, God is able to come through for you. He has the power to bring a breakthrough in your life, whether it be healing, right? You need a financial breakthrough in your life. Hey, God has the power, He has the ability to bring that breakthrough in your life. Right? But our hearts need to be set apart for God. Right? Maybe we're here and you know we're a Christian. But there's certain areas in our lives where we haven't fully surrendered to God. There's certain things that we haven't released control to God. Can I challenge you? A heart that is set apart for God is the beginning of breakthrough, right? And before receiving the miracle, right? Elijah recognized that he needed to repair the altar, which represented the relationship between God and the people. He needed to repair the altar. Right? In verse 30, he says, this was just before he went and did everything. Before he did anything, he said to the people, "Come here to me." Right? They came to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. Right? Elijah recognized that, hey, in order for me to receive that miracle, in order for me to receive that breakthrough that I'm going to ask for, I need to repair the altar in my life. And that represents the relationship between him and God. Right? And this morning, I think we need to ask ourselves, hey, and allow the Holy Spirit to search us. Hey, are there things in our life that we need to repair? Right? Are there things in our relationship with God that we need to repair? Right? And later on, we're going to have some time to just respond to that. And so a heart that is set apart for God is the beginning of breakthrough. Right? And breakthrough comes with the right attitude. Right? It comes with the right attitude. Because the attitude that we carry determines our response. Right? It determines our response. I was reading, I think this week, I was watching, it was like a comic. Right? It's basically about a guy being rejected by a girl. And the friend was asking, like, but after being rejected, he was still walking around, smiling and stuff. And his friend asked, like, "Hey, why are you so? You just got rejected by a girl. Why are you still smiling and being happy?" And he said this: "I might have lost someone who didn't care about me, but she just lost someone that cared about her." I was like, "Oh, okay, that's a pretty good attitude, right, John?" Right? First of all, the attitude that we carry determines our response. Everybody say attitude. Right? The right attitude that we carry determines our response. And today, whatever situation that we're in, we can choose what attitude we want to carry. Right? A negative attitude hinders faith. Right? If you have a negative attitude, your faith is not going to be able to come up. Right, your faith is not going to be able to rise up, and in turn dictate your response, right? But a negative attitude hinders faith. But a heart and attitude that's aligned to God builds faith, right? That builds faith, right? It's like Brother Charles, right? when a normal person gets into an accident, right, they'll be screaming and shouting in pain. But if you carry a good attitude, an attitude that's aligned to God, my brother Charles, you'll be having a prayer meeting, even though you just had an accident, right? Right after the accident, he was like, hey, come, let's pray, you know? And I'm sure that person was shocked, right? So a negative attitude hinders faith, right? And we might not have control of the situation that we're in sometimes, right? But we have full control of the attitude that we want to carry in that situation and into the situation, right? You know, we don't have control over a lot of things, right? If we're sick today, we don't have control of, like, okay, I'm going to press the reset button and everything is just going to be normal again, right? But we have an attitude, we have control over the attitude that we want to carry into the situation. And if we carry the right attitude in that situation, then in turn determines our response, right? Elijah was alone facing all the prophets of Baal. I think, if I'm not wrong, there were over 450 of them. And he was alone. He was standing there by himself. The people of Israel were like, hey, you're on your own, right? And there were other prophets that were all in hiding in caves and all over the place. So he was alone, standing against, like, 450 prophets of Baal who were smashing themselves. You know, who knew? Maybe they could have offered him as a sacrifice. But Elijah was alone in the situation, right? But he didn't give in to fear or discouragement, right? He didn't give in to fear or discouragement. He could easily have said, like, hey, I'm done. There are 450 of you. I'm getting out of here, right? Let's do this one-on-one. I'm gone. But he didn't, right? And he didn't allow that negativity to come into his heart, right? You know, and today, let's ask ourselves, like, hey, are we in a position, right? Are we facing negativity in our pursuit of a breakthrough? Right? Are we facing negativity in our pursuit of a breakthrough? I remember about a year ago today, and John would know what I'm talking about. About a year ago, and this is a testimony about one of our young people. Maybe a year and a half ago, I introduced 2 years. I gave John a contact one Sunday afternoon, and I was like, hey, can you follow up this guy? He's like, yeah, sure. We met a guy and everything. And at that point, after interacting with this guy, we're like, wow, this guy is quite something. Right? He wasn't a Christian, right? He wasn't an atheist, right? He was like, who is God? I don't believe in this God and everything. And John was trying to counsel him and trying to explain certain things to him, trying to evangelize to him and tell him, like, hey, you know, this is who Jesus is and stuff. And this guy was giving John a really hard time. And causing him a lot of distress, right? Some of the leaders in our region would know. Truly, it was a tough time. But in that situation, there were times when John was really discouraged, and he was like, hey, man, this guy, I don't know how to deal with this guy anymore. I don't know how to respond to him anymore. And there was a lot of negativity and discouragement, right? You know, but together as leaders in the region, we encouraged him, you know, and we said, like, hey, let's do this together. We'll pray for you, right? We'll try to chip in and help in the situation how we can, right? And 2 years later today, right, this young person is sitting here, right? His name is Donovan, right? He encountered God. His life is not the same anymore, right? You ask anyone, everybody will tell you, like, yeah, this guy has changed, right? And it's very, yeah, I'm quite sure, right? And it's not like anything that, you know, we do, right? It's the way that we approach the situation is the same, right? But he encountered God, and his life was never the same again, right? But the only thing that we did in the situation was that we persevered, pushed through, and we believe that, hey, you know what, God can. As long, we knew that as long as Raji turned to John, all we need is just for him to encounter God. And we know that he will be changed. He will be different. And that's what happened. He encountered God. And today he's helping other people encounter God. Right? Just last week, he went out for street evangelism to share the gospel with 7 people, just him and his dad leader. Right? And so we can see that, hey, breakthrough comes with the right attitude. Amen? Amen? Right, so don't let the situation determine your response. I never let the situation determine your response. Because you might not have control of the situation, but you have control of your response, of your attitude, right? So we need to align our hearts and attitudes to God. Secondly, we need to position ourselves in faith and expectancy. Everybody say faith and expectancy, right? So because faith always demands a response from God. And that's the cool thing. It always demands a response from God, right? It catches the attention of God. Hebrews 11 verse 6 says this, and it is impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to Him must believe that God exists and that He rewards those who seek Him. Right? God is attracted to faith. That's something that catches His eye, right? And there are many things that happens in this world, in this universe, but the thing that catches His eye is faith, right? We can see this, you know, in the Gospels. It was there are a couple of times, like the faith of the centurion, right? This guy who he just said, like, hey Jesus, my daughter is sick and I need you to come and heal her. But hey, you don't even need to come. Just say the word and I know that she will be healed. And Jesus was like, wow, this guy's faith is, I've never seen anyone like this, right? And even the woman with the issue of blood, she had a sickness in her body for so many years, and in her mind she's like, all I need to do is just touch the hem of His garment. I just need to touch Jesus' cloak or His shirt and I will be healed. And Jesus is like, wow, woman, your faith has made you well. Right? You know, so faith catches the attention of God, and He's attracted to faith, right? And for Elijah, right, he needed faith, right, in his situation. When he asked, he was about to like ask God to light the altar with fire, right? But he said, like, hey, you know what? Let's push things to the next level, right? Pour 3 jugs of water on this thing, right? The Bible tells us that, hey, you know, he dug a trench. Even the trench was filled with water. Right? He needed some faith, right? And the miracle came, right, as a direct response to his faith. Right? The miracle came as a direct response to his faith, right? To the faith that he had. Right? Even the in Elijah's situation, right, God saw his faith, and therefore, right, the fire came, right? The centurion and the woman with the issue of blood, right, they received the healing because of their faith. And the Bible says it very clearly, your faith has made you well. And that's what Jesus said to the woman. Right? Your faith has made you well. Right? And the miracle and the breakthrough that they received was a direct response to the faith that they had. Right? So then Elijah had no doubt that God was able to come through. Right? So faith always demands a response from God. Right? So let's decide to let faith dictate our decisions. Right? Let faith dictate our decisions. Right? Because when we believe in faith, when we start to choose to say, like, hey, I'm gonna believe in faith, we're gonna start deciding and acting in faith. Right? Because if we don't believe in faith, then everything that we do will be just out of a natural response. Right? But even in our hearts, in our mind, we say, like, hey, I'm gonna choose to believe in faith, I'm gonna choose to act in faith, to respond in faith, then everything that comes on after, everything that you decide, everything that you act, everything that you say, it will be out of faith. Right? So let faith dictate our actions, right? And Elijah acted according to his faith and not according to natural circumstances. Right? He was 1 versus 450. Right? He was pouring water onto an altar that was about to be lit on fire. Right? And he didn't, he acted according to his faith, the faith that he had in who God is, right? And what God can do, right? So, and listen to this, a response in faith reaps a supernatural result, right? A response in faith reaps a supernatural result, right? And today, if we respond naturally to a situation, to a circumstance, right, we can expect a natural response, a natural result, right? But if we respond in faith, we can expect a supernatural result, right? You know, and today, whatever situation that we're going through, are we responding to these situations, right, naturally, with a natural response, Or are we responding to the situation in faith? Maybe we're believing for a breakthrough, right? For a family salvation, right? Are we responding naturally to the situation? Right? Are we responding with a natural response? Right? Are we responding in faith today? Right? So let faith dictate your decisions. Right? And faith is this, it's the fuel to hope and perseverance. Right? Faith is the fuel to hope and perseverance. Right? Elijah was living in a time of drought and famine for 3.5 years, and he's constantly being hunted down. Right? People, this guy Ahab was looking for him. Right? He was going across towns, cities, and everything, looking, have you seen the prophet Elijah? Have you seen the prophet Elijah? He was constantly being hunted down. Right? And it was a depressing time for him to be in, right? But his faith in God strengthened him, right? It strengthened him in this time to even to stand up to Ahab, to present himself to Ahab. And that required faith in God, in who God is and what God says, right? To present yourself to the person that's gonna kill you, right? When we put our faith in God, we're putting our faith in someone who is able, and we're putting our faith in someone who is unchanging, right? And when we know that we can count on this person, right, it's easier for us to have hope, right? It's easier for us to say, like, hey, you know what? I have hope in who Jesus is. I have hope that God is going to be able to come into my situation and do something, right? You know, and because I have that faith in who God is and what he can do, I have that hope, right? I'm able to persevere in this situation. I'm able to push through the times when I'm feeling discouraged. I'm able to push through the times when I'm feeling lousy and feeling hopeless. Right? Because of my faith in who God is, I can have hope and perseverance. Right? And so we position ourselves in faith and expectancy. Right? Expectation creates an atmosphere for faith to work. Right, and that's the kick, that's the punch, that's the power in having that expectation, right? When there's a story about the four friends who brought a paralytic to Jesus and said, and really cut, because there was a crowd, they couldn't go in through the doors or the windows. They had climbed to the roof, dig a hole through the roof, and lowered him down, right? But these guys, they had an expectation, right? They had an expectation. In their mind, they're looking at the cross and like, all we need to do is just put our friend in front of Jesus, and he's gonna do something, right? He's gonna do something, right? They don't know how they're gonna do it, right? But they had an expectation, right? They had an expectation that, hey, as long as we get Jesus' attention, we're okay, right? He's gonna be okay. And he had an expectation. Everybody say expectation. Right? And Elijah, he had an expectation that God will show up. Right? He had an expectation that God is going to show his power when the time came. Right? That's why he went up to Ahab. Right? That's why when God told him, like, hey, go present yourself to Ahab, he's like, okay, I'm going to go. But you better show up. Right? And he knew that God's going to show up. And that God's going to show up, and he's going to show up in a big way. Right? And it was expectation that charged them up in their faith. Right? It was expectation that charged them up in their faith. Because they knew that, and their mind's like, hey, I have an expectation. All I need to do is just get Jesus's, all I need is to get his attention. And as long as I get his attention, all I need is, I just put this guy in front of him, and I know God's going to do something. And that's faith. Right? Because of that expectation that they had, it charged up their faith. And so when we pray, an expectation, it charges them up in their faith, and it brings you closer to your breakthrough. Right? It brings you closer to your breakthrough. Right? We were talking just now, right? A negative attitude hinders faith. Right? But when we have expectation, it brings you one step closer to your breakthrough. Right? Because you will push more, you will believe more in faith, right? You will hope more, you will persevere more. Right? So expectation brings you closer to your breakthrough. So when we pray and ask for a breakthrough, let's not just pray for the sake of praying, but let's pray with expectation. You know, when we ask God, hey God, I need you to come into my situation. God, I need you to break to heal me. I need you to come into this. Right? Let's not just pray and then, you know, okay, that's it, right? Let's pray with an expectation. Right? You know, I was just in a meeting with Sister Iman, I think it was last week, and we were praying for she was just asking, like, hey, is anybody sick here? You know, we're gonna pray for you if you're sick. And most times when we pray for someone who's sick, we just like we'll lay our hands on the person, we'll pray, and then after that we'll lay hands and pray, and then after that, okay, I'll talk, right? And then that's it, right? You know, take care. But in this meeting, Sister Infant was saying, like, hey, let's pray for people who are sick, right? So who's sick? Okay, raise your hands. Okay, what's wrong? You know, what's wrong? Okay, come, everybody, let's lay hands and pray, right? We pray, and then okay, finish. Then everybody just step back, normal. And then Sister Infant just like stood there, like, so how? We're like, what are you feeling? How? Are you feeling better? And I think some of them will call up, like, don't know whether to say, like, you know. And they're like, no, it's okay, just tell me, just say the truth. Like, how are you? Are you feeling better? No, not really. Okay, everybody, come, let's pray again. Okay? And then pray again. And by this time, everybody knew, okay, she's gonna ask us later how you feel. So come, let's pray. Right? And this time, people pray with more expectation, more faith. You know, pray again. And then this day, much up, she says, so how are you feeling better? Yeah, feeling better. Right away. I trust that they weren't lying, they had an expectation and that's why they were healed, right? You know, but that's what expectation does, right? Right? That's what expectation does. It creates an atmosphere for faith to work. And so when the next time we're praying and believing God for a breakthrough, let's not slip into like a normal prayer mode where we just I lay hands on myself and I pray for myself and stuff like that. Right? But let's pray with an expectation, believing that hey, God's gonna do something. Right? And when we expect something, right, our faith is built, our faith is charged up. And when we pray in faith, right, that catches the attention of God. Right? So we need to position ourselves in faith and expectancy. And lastly, we need to position ourselves in purity and selflessness. Right? And what it means, what purity means, to position ourselves in purity, it means to choose God's will over our own. Right? Most of the time when we talk about purity, we're just talking about sexual purity. Right? But there's a bigger meaning to that than just sexual purity. Right? It means to choose God's will over our own. Right? Purity means to choose to love God more than we love anything else. Right? Even to the point where we have to give certain things up, right? Our preferences, our priorities.